You're able to understand how rajasic or tamasic or sattvic the mind is. Is it a pleasant experience or unpleasant experience? It's a pleasant experience to observe the mind. Sometimes pleasant, sometimes unpleasant also, that what this mind is capable of thinking. Nice, fresh, after bath, in a clean place, wearing clean clothes, you sit down and you think, let me observe the mind and look at the things that it can think of, irrespective of whether you had bath or you had clean clothes in a clean place, in a pure and silent environment. Look at where the mind can go and think of what all. That is why I keep saying antaranga shuddhi is more important than bahiranga shuddhi. Of course, both are important, but antaranga shuddhi is the most important. You read all the Upanishads, all the Vedas, ultimately they will say only the person who is desireless and pure can he attain Brahman. Brahman is not for anyone else, not the most erudite scholar, not the most great exponent of the Vedas, not the one who can win debates or argue on the concepts of Vedanta, but who the one who is desireless and therefore pure alone qualifies to know the truth, nobody else. So can you imagine, all that is just boiling down to being desireless. Did you notice that? Desireless, what is a desire? It is a thought that pursues its fulfillment. If a thought does not pursue its fulfillment, it is not a desire, it's just a thought. This is a table. I want that table for myself. The difference between the two. One is a thought, this is just a table. Nice table, well done, well designed, well painted. That's a thought. That also disturbs the mind. But the moment the thought turns into a desire, I want that table. Punarapi jananam punarip. For the sake of table, you will be born again if you don't get the table in this birth. I keep joking and I tell the man story of a man who thought he would name his sons as Govinda, Krishna, Madhava, Gopala, so that when he is dying, his last thoughts would be, he would call upon his sons and by chanting their name, whatever, Krishna, Govinda, Madhava, he would attain moksha. He thought so. So as he was dying, he called upon all his sons. Hey, Govinda, Krishna, Madhava, Gopala, all four of them came. And he said, if all four of you are here, who is at the shop? And he died. Then I further tell that he was reborn as a rat in the shop, because always he could stay in the shop, whether it's open or closed, because his dying thoughts were such. So this external purification, external rituals, name yourself, your children, your home, your car as Krishna, Madhava, Govinda, Gopala, even your maid servant, Saraswati, Lakshmi, Kali, does not matter. At the end of it, the internal makeup, the mind that is internal, that is what's called antahkarana, that has to be pure. And desireless mind alone is capable of knowing the truth. All other minds, rajas mind, sattvic mind, tamasic mind, are not capable of knowing the truth. A thoughtless mind, a desireless mind alone is capable of knowing the truth. So Anandavalli in Taittiriya Upanishad goes on to say, I was mentioning the other day, we all want Ananda, Ananda pipasa. Even an ant wants joy. An insect wants joy in some form or the other. Everybody knowingly or unknowingly is pursuing the experience of being joyful. Nobody wants sorrow. So knowingly or unknowingly, we are all on the spiritual path. We want that ananda only. Nobody is saying, I don't want ananda. But we don't know where is ananda. We think ananda lies in the things of the world. You buy a new car, there is ananda. Buy a new house, there is ananda. marriage is ananda, children is ananda, getting a big position and a job is ananda. And we keep thinking and keep pursuing these goals, thinking that this is what will give us ananda. But at the end of it, like the kasturi mruga, the musk deer, it runs everywhere searching for ananda, and finally when it gets tired and curls up to rest, it smells and it knows that the fragrance is coming from its own navel. That's all is the story of every man, every woman who pursues ananda in the world. They run around the forest searching for it. At the end, when they get tired, I tried everything and I did not find complete joy. I found some bouts of joy, some bits of joy, but I never found the joy that came and stayed forever. And therefore, finally the person get tired, not in one birth, in several births of this pursuit. Finally the realization dawns upon that person by the grace of Guru or by the grace of God that by what I am following, what I am pursuing is not going to stay. All these are temporary. Mirage. So finally when he gets tired and curls up at the feet of the Guru, that I am here for you, I am here with you, you give me the jnana. I have searched everywhere, I did not find it. And then Guru says, check out, it's there right inside you. And you turn inside and see the antarmukha, and you realize, yes, this ananda is right inside me, it's not outside me. And your journey completes there. So becoming desireless is the only way to become one with divinity. And somebody may ask, a lot of students have written, knowing you, wanting to know God, even praying for moksha, is that not a desire? It is a desire, I definitely, it is a desire. Swami says, you should work for realization, you should ask for realization, you should strive for realization. So knowingly or unknowingly, intentionally or unintentionally, you have developed a desire. And that thought which is pursued is desire, that is what I said. It was just a thought, there is self-realization and I have got nothing to do with it. It will remain a thought, it will die down in the passage of time. And other thoughts and desires will take over. But this is one thought that changed into a desire in you. Mumukshatva, he said, one of the pillars of self-realization, the path of self-realization is mumukshatva. The terrible, tremendous burning sensation that I want to know God. I cannot live like this another moment, another day. It drives you every moment, waking and asleep. All the time this one thought is weighing on your mind. I must realize, I must realize. Is that not a desire is the question. So if any desire is there, and the Vedas say, Upanishads say, any desire, you're not going to get God. But what about the desire for God? What is the desire for realization? That is also desire. So technically, going by the whatever has been told, you are not supposed to attain God because you are desiring for God. So what is the solution? There is somebody who has written. So I said, you know, in the old times, these pandits, I was mentioning about temples and the brahmanas eat. So much they eat. How much they eat is this? Three people, four people, they can eat in one go. Durvasa, and even present day Brahmins generally are like that. So after eating, what they will do, they'll take a piece of ginger and eat that also. Why they will eat ginger? To digest all the food that they've eaten. Ginger is a digestive. Now when you eat ginger also gets digested along with the food, isn't it? Ginger doesn't stay separately. Ginger becomes a part of the food and gets digested. Similarly, this desire to know God gets digested in knowing God. So that desire becomes God. It won't stay. In fact, it will help you reach God, like ginger helps you to digest the food. And it also in the process gets digested and assimilated. Likewise, the desire to know God will help you know God. And at the end of knowing God, this knowing desire to know God also will be digested, assimilated and taken care of. So that desire of knowing God is a good desire which helps you to know God. At the end, that desire also becomes one with the process of knowing God and it also gets digested. So it does not create indigestion. it creates digestion of this thought of God. So all the scriptures that you read to know God, understand God, everything gets digested with this one desire of knowing God. And once you know God, all the food, all the knowledge, everything gets completely taken care of. So having this desire to know God is actually not a, technically, actually not a desire which turns us towards the world. It turns us towards God. Manam moolam idam jagat. Mind, you turn towards world, it binds you. Turn towards God, it liberates you. Mind is the key. So mind only is the key. Thing is that you should be always be capable of turning it towards God, not away from it. So to develop a desire to turn your mind towards God is what you all are practicing. To stabilize the mind, make the mind listen to you and do what you want it to do and not make you do what it wants. Ultimately, force the mind or coax the mind or sweet talk the mind into turning towards God. And finally, you will become God. Once you have become God, you don't need, once you have climbed, you don't need the ladder. So to that extent only this mind is. But without the ladder, can you climb? Without the key, can you open the door? So mind is important. Therefore, training the mind is a process. And that is what I was trying to tell you, that how do you train the mind by observing it, understanding its nature, how naughty it is, how quiet it is, how sattvic, how tamasic, and accordingly working on its training. Another week you watch over and remove the unwanted thoughts. You see, like you go to a bookshelf, clean up all that which you don't want. You go to your cupboard, all the clothes that are old and unnecessary, you clean it up. But first you have to observe the cupboard, whether how many clothes are there and how many fit and how many don't fit. You have accumulated plenty over a period of time. So the first step, I said, first week is observe, identify which are to be thrown away, which are to be kept. That is the first step. Finally, second step, what you do is, you tell the mind, discard these. First step is observe, second step is discard. I don't want these clothes, I don't want these unnecessary thoughts. Let's just throw out. Till one thought remains, which is that thought? That I must realize God. Don't throw that also out, along with the rest. Baby with the bath water. Don't do that. Keep that one desire. That's why I said, finally, dharana I have to have. So throw everything else out and keep this one desire, I want to know God. And in that one desire, strengthen that thought. I want to know God. I want to know God. So the third stage, what you do, you hold this one thought in your mind. I want to know God. Everything else is, can be thrown away. All other desires, all other wants, ideas can be thrown away. Because I know if I know God, I know everything. Kasminnu bhagavo vijñāte sarvamidam vijñātam bhavati. What should I know so that I know everything? It means I can know medicine, I can know engineering, I can know everything. Truth is that. I can know everything. What is that I should know? So this says that you should know Brahman to know everything. The clay, if you know the pots. Gold, if you know the ornaments. Likewise, just know yourself. So that one desire you should hold. Now some of these highly, I don't know which school that is, Mimamsa school of people. Swami, I should throw this desire also, isn't it? Because if it's a desire in my head that I want to know God, I may not know God. At the end, I may not be able to, but that's not the bad desire. That's the one desire that you should hold in your mind. I need to know God. If you throw that out, then you know which direction you're going. Till you reach God. So you keep that in mind. Third week, you hold that, I need to know God. How do I need to know God? Very beautifully again, Upanishads. Always Upanishads to our rescue. They have all experienced it, written it, digested it, and out of compassion, they could have just kept quiet and said that, I know the answer, why should I tell others? But they wrote the answer for us also, out of compassion. Pranavo dhanu. Om is the bow. Sharohi atma. The arrow is my own self. Brahma tad laksham uchyate. Its goal is Brahman. Om is the bow. I am the arrow. And my goal is Brahman. And how do I attain that? Think of shooting. So anybody who does shooting an arrow, not the, that also we can, but those times there were no guns, so the rishis didn't write about guns. They wrote only about bows and arrows. So a bow and arrow. So the rishi writes, there is a bow called Om. There is an arrow, there is an arrow called you. Put yourself on this bow of Om and shoot. And whom should you shoot? It should go and hit the target. The bullseye is Brahman, the realization. And how do you do that? If you want to shoot, how steady you should be. If you shake and if you, you know, if you don't have enough force, enough strength, also enough steadiness. Both are not there. Can it go? If you have enough steadiness but no strength, it will fall halfway. If enough strength and no steadiness, what will happen? It will go and hit somewhere else. Both are required, two things. What is that? One, steady, sthiratvam. And the strength. Nayamatma balahinena labhya. To the weak, Atman cannot be realized by weak. It has to be realized by the strong. So he says, you hold this Om, hold yourself as the arrow and hit the target called Brahman. And how do you hit that? Apramattena, the one who does not waver. Also, one who does not fall into the wrong ways of things. The way it should be done, that is the way it should be done. Does not fall into the wrong distractions at that moment, the one who is going to hit the target. So, apramattena, the one who should not deviate, should not get distracted, should not fall into the lower ways, but keep his focus on the goal. Vedavyam finally hits it. Who hits it? Only apramattena, the one who is very steady and focused alone hits it. All others will hit everywhere else. But only the steady and focused hits the target. And what is the? What happens once you hit the target? Sharvat tanmayo bhavayat. Like the arrow becomes one with the target, you become one with Brahman. Very simply explained. Why I told this is because, why again I insist on steadiness of the mind? Purity is one and steadiness is another, I kept on telling. Purity is the strength of the mind. A pure mind is a strong mind. Desireless mind is the strongest mind. A mind full of desires is the weakest mind. Can be tempted, distracted, can be dissuaded from its path very easily. If you have one desire in your head, the mind will take you on the wrong path. Just because you want to fulfill that desire, isn't it? Hook or crook. Some way or the other. So that desire makes the mind weak. So how can an archer hit a target with no strength? Or if he has all the strength, you have no desire, but his mind is not steady, very restless, fickle. Even then the arrow will not be able to hit the target. You will go and hit somewhere else. You will not be able to reach the goal. So that is why I said observe the mind, remove or discard unwanted things first. It is like less traffic on the road. So you know now that I have to go this way. Traffic is less, less thoughts are crowding my mind. And whatever limited thoughts are there, good thoughts are there, let me keep if I'm not able to throw them. But bad thoughts I have to remove. Because if I don't remove and don't become desireless, I will not have enough strength to reach the target. I will fall off halfway. Even though I'm so focused, I will not have the momentum, the strength to go that far. So I need to be pure. Purity of mind is desirelessness. That is mind's strength. Truth people think those are powerful people who can fulfill their desires. Wrest it out of the circumstances. Whatever, I want to be the politician, I want to be the prime minister, I want to be this. If I can achieve that, I am powerful, isn't it? Why go over that far? In a family, a father thinks that way or mother thinks that way. In a class, some student or a teacher thinks that way. All these are not powers. They look like powers, but they are illusions, they are fakes. The real power is in the person who has no desire. Therefore, nobody can tempt him. Nobody can rule over him. When Alexander the Great called upon that half-naked man who was sleeping under the tree, ask him to come, I'll give him prizes, I'm not coming. Come, otherwise I'll cut his head. I'm still not coming. If he had even the desire to hold on to his flesh and his body, you think he could have said no to Alexander, knowing very well that he has killed half the world on the way? No desire. That's why he is strong. Vivekananda said, spirituality is for the strong, it's not for the weak. Same thing Upanishad, Nayamatma balahinena labhya, it cannot be attained by the weak people. Weak not in the body, body also has to be healthy and strong. No doubt, but mind is more importantly. And what is the strength of the mind? not having any desire is the strength of the mind. Having desire is going to weaken the mind. So now you have to practice as you observe the mind that what kind of desires are there in you. I want this, I want that, I want to be like that. It may not be very, I'm not saying they're bad or tremendously bad, but there are, you know, sattva is a desire, some desire, but good desire. I want to know God. Sattvic desire. Let the whole world, samasta loka, sukhino bhavantu. Holy desire. Let no one have any sorrow. Sarves bhavantu sukhina. Holy desire, good desire. That you keep, I'm not saying throw that away. But if you have a rajasic mind still, when you're observing your mind, and you notice there are plenty of desires. It may be very small, you know, small things like I want to have a better food, or I want to have a little more comfortable stay, or I want to go to some place, or I want to see some person, or I want to do anything that is not selfless is not sattvic. Okay? So in the rajasic desires, you have to start watching them very carefully. Now that you are already observing, start knowing those desires that are not sattvic, because these are the desires that will weaken you. And this will not allow the arrow to reach its destination later. It will reduce, it will drain you of your tremendous tanviryam, they call it. The strength, the ojas, they call it. It will not help you reach if you don't have that strength in your mind and body also. So when you're observing this, the next step is to observe desires and categorize them very carefully. How many sattvic I have, how many rajasic I have, and there are some tamasic. Tamas means inert. What is inert in us? Body is inert in us. Isn't it? Body is jada. It's not chaitanya. It cannot, if you are dead, your prana goes out. Is body capable of doing anything on its own? It's a piece of flesh lying around and starts stinking after some time. Degenerates. So jada. So anything which needs, which body is capable of enjoying. Body. It could be a food that is not, that is very tasty but not sattvic, not nice. It's not good for your spiritual health. A kind of clothing which is nice to look at, but it is not nice. A kind of lifestyle habit, be it sleeping, be it enjoying any other pleasures of the eyes, ears, nose, mouth, skin, which is not sattvic in nature, which is to be experienced only through the sense organs. Which sense organs? This, karmendriyas. Which has to be observed through karmendriyas. Without hand or without mouth or without eyes or ears or skin, you cannot enjoy that. All those are tamasic desires. All those are tamasic desires. I am helping you categorize now. So if without your hand or head or whatever, the five indriyas, if you are incapable of enjoying it, then know for sure that that is a tamasic desire. Needs to be shunned and discarded. Then there are desires which you can experience mentally, emotionally. It may or may not involve the physical activities. It may involve, may not involve. You're reading a book, a good book. It involves your eyes. But more importantly, involves your intelligence. These physical desires don't require intelligence. They're just driven by the instincts, not the intelligence. So desires that are driven by instincts are tamasic desires. And they involve only the jada part of the body, largely. With mind, of course, is the ruler of all the senses. So mind, anyway, we are trying to purify, right? We don't want mind to associate with things. We don't want it to get spoiled by in wrong company. So first thing is, anything that is experienced through your physical body and the physical senses are all tamasic in nature. You sit and contemplate on this and list down all that you experience through your physical body and the mind. That's all. The mind and body are involved, nothing else. Then you have a little higher desires, rajasic desires. These include body, these involve body, but it also involves intelligence, not instincts. It involves intelligence. You think about those things, you discriminate, you analyze. I want to win a war. It will involve the body. But you also need to involve your discretion, your intelligence, your higher faculties have to come into picture. Your chitta and buddhi, have to come into picture. Those desires are rajasic, generally rajasic in nature. They'll have physical activity, obviously. For example, you want to win a game. You cannot win the game by just watching the game. You have to physically get involved. Your all five senses will be totally involved. But your higher intelligence is at work. It's not by instinct that you are doing. Instinctive desires are all animal desires. Animals live by instinct. They don't live by intelligence. Their intelligence is very primitive, only to the extent of escaping danger and saving themselves or finding their food. Basically, they're instincts only. They're not intelligence. That intelligence is instinctive intelligence. Ant also has instinctive. You put your foot there, ant will deviate and go from the other way. Not that it thought about what has come in my way, looks like a man's foot. No, it's a woman's foot. It doesn't think like this. It takes a deviation and runs. Instinct kicks in. So anything that we enjoy with simply the body and mind involved, the sense organs involved, but no intelligence, no discrimination, no chitta, no buddhi, are all tamasic desires. They have to be kept under great check and control, because they are the ones who drain away mind's strength. So they have to be limited. That is the first thing. The middle part, the rajasic desires are those who involve mind and buddhi. However, they may or may not involve the body entirely, or they may involve a sense or two. Singing example. You're singing bhajans, but you need to involve your body in it. You need to think. And there is a kind of joy that you derive. Not because I say pibare ramarasam, you don't feel sweetness on your tongue. Do you feel? Not like you put a sweet candy on your tongue and you feel the sweetness. Pibare ramarasam, you still feel the sweetness. But where do you feel the sweetness? Is it on your tongue? It is in your antakkarana, the mind. The chitta is able to enjoy that. Your physical body is not enjoying pibare ramarasam, like panakam or like sharbat or like sweet juice. Your body is not enjoying the rasam. Who is enjoying? Only the mind is largely involved. But of course, body is involved in acting, in the sense singing or listening to that song or thinking and meditating on it. So mind is involved. Body is involved to a limited extent. But who is the beneficiary? Who enjoys it? Your inside, your mind and your buddhi and your chitta, the antakarna enjoy it. The physical body does not enjoy rama rasam. So that is a higher level of enjoyment. So keep those enjoyments with you and discard as many possible of the physical nature. It doesn't mean you don't eat food tomorrow. You have to eat. But what kind of food is the question I'm asking? Sattvic food. It doesn't mean that you close your eyes and don't see anything. You see, but what kind of sights? These are the questions you have to ask. Those pleasures which are derived out of senses only with the help of the mind are tamasic in nature, discriminate, discard. Then those pleasures which are experienced by the mind with limited involvement of the body or senses, they are largely rajasic in nature. I want to be famous. Now, famousness has nothing to do with your leg, hand, eyes, nose, ears. The physical senses don't enjoy your famous or fame or being famous. Who enjoys? Mind enjoys with limited involvement of the sense. Of course, if you are famous, your photo will be put up on the, because they want to know who is that person who is famous. To that extent, your physical body is involved. But largely what is involved? Mind alone is involved. Your buddhi alone is involved. So those joys which are experienced by the buddhi and mind, an intellectual joy, I cracked a puzzle. There is a joy. It involves some senses, but largely the joy came not because of sensual involvement, it came because of your intellectual involvement. Those are generally rajasic in nature. Again, make a list of those. They are less harmful, but if they can lead to ego and arrogance, which is again detrimental to one's spiritual progress. I am very intelligent. I am smart. All these can lead to unnecessary trouble on this path. Again, they weaken you. They weaken you to a little lesser extent, but they do weaken you. Okay? There is a middle level of weakness you can call. Then there are sattvic desires. See, now I'm coming to, this is very crucial and you must pay attention. These two, you have understood the kind of desires. Now think of this sattvic desire. I want to be good. I want to be good. Being good is not a problem. I want to be known as good. I want to be known as spiritual. I want to be known as selfless. I want to be known as man of sacrifice. If you want to be good for goodness sake, whether somebody sees or does not see, does not matter. Somebody knows or does not know, does not matter. Somebody praises, acknowledges or doesn't, does not matter. You're happy to do it in your own sweet, silent corner, whatever good you want to do. That is being good for goodness sake. But if your goodness comes with a tag, then let at least somebody acknowledge that I'm good. You're so good. You're so helpful. There is a pleasure. Is there or not? This pleasure is of another nature. That pleasure with physical senses is one nature. That pleasure with the mind and intellect is of one nature. That pleasure with hits your heart, touches. I have been, at least somebody finally realized that I am one good soul in this whole ashram. Till now, nobody even realized that how much selfless service I am doing. Nobody acknowledges it. Forget, Swami is the last to acknowledge. Even the people around me don't acknowledge it. What's the use? I'm good. You are good. I'm sure you are good because you're doing good to everyone. But that goodness is not for goodness's sake. That is a sattvic desire. It's a good desire. It involves your heart. Also, it will involve your mind, intelligence, intellect, and your body, senses, everything. You want to do service to somebody. Like somebody is sick. You want to go and deliver food or look after the person. Heart has spoken. Only if it has spoken that I must do it because that is what my duty as a human being, as a co-traveler on this path, as an ashramite, as a another human with a heart. It is my duty. Let me go and do. But as you are going, you know what? Where I am going? I am going to that room number so and so. That lady has come. She is very sick. You know, I am going to deliver food. After two more steps, you know, somebody else. Do you know where I am going? And after you give that lady, you come back again. Do you know what I did? That is also a pleasure. You enjoy. Something inside you touches you. Definitely touches you. You feel happier than feeling happy about cracking a puzzle or enjoying some food. It is a higher level of pleasure. But then it is derived because somebody has acknowledged your service or work. It's not been goodness for goodness's sake. So there also desires. And that is also desire, though sattvic in nature. Now will you be able to categorize it even finally? Finer categorization. These are the very tamasic ones. They will weaken my arrow will not reach the destination. Because these desires will weaken me and I will not be having enough strength. So physical discard. Then you come to the intellectual, the mind related, intellectually related. And think from there also, what are the kind of pleasures that I seek intellectually? I am a good orator. I like to be known as it. And I enjoy if I give a great speech. I also enjoy, there is no doubt about it. But I enjoy because I have been able to pass some good idea to somebody and hopefully they'll benefit from that point of view, not from the point of view of exhibiting my knowledge and my oratory skills. That's not the idea behind my speaking. But there may be some. I will sing. I like singing. But for what sake? For what reason? So that I bring joy to God, to myself, and also to all those who are listening to these bhajans. Beyond that, there is no goal of my singing. It is not to prove my singing talent. So that enjoyment that comes out of singing is not for my sake. It comes for everybody else. It's for others' sake. And I also get to eat a little bit out of it. If a prasadam is made for the temple, pujari also gets to eat a little bit. Though he cooks for everyone, but he also eats a little bit. So to that extent only I enjoy that. So that intellectual, emotional enjoyments are only to that extent. Any other intellect and emotional enjoyments that drain you of your energy, which are largely coming in the form of ego and attachments. Ego and attachments are nothing to do with the body. Don't misunderstand. Only when mind thinks, it becomes ego. If mind does not think, it is not an ego. If mind desires, it becomes an attachment. If mind does not desire, it is not an attachment. So rajasic level, all these ego attachments are. So you have to find out where all I do things and I suffer through this problem of ego and attachments. Well, you should start getting rid of those also. I want to look, I am beautiful, everybody should know that, I am handsome, or I sing well, I speak well. Enjoy those things, but for whose sake is the question. You do it because that helps somebody else, not just you. Good writer, painter, singer, dancer, anything, you could be a good, very good academician. But no ego comes into picture, no attachment comes out of it. Then you are able to control those rajasic thoughts also. And sattvic thoughts are pure selfless thoughts which are not for your sake, for others, or for God. Where your heart is involved, not your head so much. Head can be used, hands can be used, but largely it is driven by heart. You see somebody in pain and suffering, you spring into action because you want to bring relief to that person. But not with the idea that at least somebody should know I brought relief to them. Or he should at least thank me and acknowledge that you have helped me. If you were not there, what would have happened to me? Even that I don't expect. That is sattvic. Desire only, but then you have removed the expectation part of it. Then it becomes a sattvic desire. But they are also finally obstacles only in the path. So this week, as you are observing your mind, observe these things and keep this thing in mind. Finally, when I fourth stage, when I meditate on the self, if I don't have enough strength for my arrow to reach its target, or enough focus for the arrows to reach the target, I will not be able to achieve it. Strength, by removing unwanted, unnecessary desires that drain you of your real energy and vitality. Those have to be discarded first. And focus comes when you have lesser desires, your heart is full of purity, you have more sattvic desires, sattvic feelings, purity and steadiness comes to the mind. Weak. Weak because to fulfill the desire, you will take to all kinds of ways. So you are a weak person, you cannot control yourself. And they make you unsteady because your mind is always jumping from one desire to the other. So desires are the reason. That is why it's very clearly Anandavalli. Who can attain Ananda? There's a Manushya Ananda, Deva Ananda, Deva Gandharva Ananda, Prajapatira Ananda, Brahma Ananda. There's a category. But how does it go? He says, either you do this. What he says? You should be a young man or a woman, as the case be. Ashishto, balishto, drishtaha. You should be very intelligent, very strong, very determined. And what should be? You should rule the entire earth. And you should own all the wealth in the earth, on the earth. Then you have manushya eko manushya anandaha. That is one unit of man's ananda. When you are young, can you be young forever? Not possible. Can you be the sharpest, the strongest, the most determined person on earth? Maybe, but not forever, because with age, mind will fade, intelligence will become dim. Can you own the entire earth and all the wealth in it? Not possible. It means you are not capable of collecting one unit of manushya ananda. And then you multiply, it goes a long way. I will explain another day how it goes all the way till Brahmananda, which we are talking about, we are aiming about at least, isn't it? Manushya ananda, then manushya gandharva ananda, then ajana jana devanamanda, pitra deva pitra ananda, then comes like this indrasya ananda, on that you go to prajapati ananda, then brahmananda, long list. So you are not capable of one manushya ananda. Multiplied by 100 is manushya gandharva ananda, the very first stage. So how do you expect brahmananda, which will be like 10 multiplied by some, I don't know, 20 zeros? It's not possible. So what is the other way? Upanishads again. Shrotriyasya cha akamahatasya. The one who has learned in the scriptures, shrotra, shruti. The one who has heard and understood, not just heard and taken out. Understood the essence of the scriptures and who is desireless. Akamahatasya. Same equivalent of that ananda is attained by that person. So which is easy? Catching here like this or catching here like this? You calculate. Obviously. So it says either you become a young man and remain young forever, like Chiranjeevi in his story, who wants to remain Chiranjeevi forever. And you own the whole earth, not one plot in Bandahalli. not even Chikbalapur, not India, not a whole earth you should own. And vittasya purna syat, all the wealth also in that. After all that you do, then you attain one unit of manushyananda. Or alternatively, multiple choice, shrotriyasya cha akamahatasya. Listen to the scriptures, the good words of the scripture, understand them, because by continuously thinking of them, your mind will become pure. It will develop dispassion, it will develop vairagya from all the other worldly things by continuously listening to that, and become desireless with exception of one desire, that I want to attain Brahmananda. That you keep for now. If you become like that, what will happen? You will attain the same Brahmananda as it comes by multiplying 100 into 100 into 100 to Manushyananda, which one is, first Manushyananda is not there. 0 into 0 is, any number of zeros is Shunyamadam. But one unit of Manushyananda we are not capable of. It's not possible. So the only other way is become desireless. Believe in the scriptures, study scriptures, understand scriptures, and become desireless. There is no other way to attain Brahmananda. Why I am saying again and again is because now you have started observing the mind, so I am trying to explain. First, foremost, put efforts and get rid of those tamasic thoughts which have to do only with the engagement of physical senses. Then put a little more effort and try to see where your pleasures are coming from the involvement of your mind and intellect. Them also you slowly discard. It doesn't mean tomorrow you don't sing and don't speak and do anything. No, you do all that. Like you have to eat your food, but in a proper way. You have to sleep, but in a limited way. You have to see things, but those which will lead you to that realization, not unwanted, unnecessary. You hear things, but with discrimination. Touch, taste, smell, whatever, with discrimination. So physical senses are subdued, and they are used only to the extent of one's healthy survival, not beyond that. All the desires will be thrown out of the window. Second is rajasic. You talk, you sing, you do study, you do everything that is needed to be done, but with the attitude of service, not for acknowledgement, not for anything. And finally, the sattvic desires, you want to be of helpful, it's not your duty. To sing is your duty, to read is your duty, study is your duty, to work in the office is your duty. That's why I called it as rajas. Do it with clear understanding of why you're doing, without any desire of deriving some pleasure out of it, of acknowledgements and fame, position, power, and things like that. Do it as service. And the sattvic desires, when you want to help someone, when you have to pray for everybody, when you have to think of good things, even there is no desire for any acknowledgements. You do it for doing sake. There was a lady who would go and distribute shawls in the night. And somebody asked, why do you distribute in the night when everybody is sleeping on the footpath? Nobody will know that you are distributing. She said, that's precisely the reason why I am distributing in the night. I don't even want the person who is sleeping on the footpath to know that I have given that shawl. That is why I am doing it in the night. I don't want to do it in the daylight. See, that kind of sattvic desires. Ultimately, you could keep one bow and one arrow. Om means that is the ultimate, that is the Parabrahman, that is the Nada, that Om iti Brahma, Om iti Atma, Om iti Satyam. Everything is Om, they say, because that one word sound has the potential of all other sounds. Om iti Sarvam. So that I will come to later, how to chant Om and spend time in the final stages. I don't want to come to that because you have not finished your observing mind. We are still in the first week exercise book. What is it? Observe your desires. Observe your mind. And why you should discard your desires? Because it will weaken you. Your arrow will not reach the destination. It will shake you. Therefore, you will not be able to hit the target. You will miss the target and you will get frustrated. After some time, you say, this archery is not for me. You will walk out. But that I don't want you to suffer at the end. So start making a list within your mental list or physical list as you feel comfortable and note down. And every day you observe, is this desire still there or it's gone? It will be hiding somewhere in the corner. So next week when we have to discard the desires, how do we start categorizing and discarding, I will teach you. Right now you just make a list and say, these are my tamasic desires, these are my rajasic desires, these are my sattvic desires, and leave it at that. I know I'm not going to come and announce all the list here. That will be very embarrassing, I know. You keep it to yourself. That's between you and me inside, not outside. First week you did that, but as you're categorizing, start categorizing rajasic, tamasic. Next week we'll work on discarding those desires which are the most terrible. They are the biggest danger to us. First learn how to come to that, which is to do with the physical body and senses and nothing more. Then we will also work on how to get rid of the intellectual ideas and desires. Finally, we'll come to the even sattvic desire, how to remain. You all know it. I'm just, it's like when we do it practically, till now we knew it in theory. This is a practical class. Day to day, we know how exactly to go about doing it. So we will do it in next week. Once we have attained some success over there, then we will work on another week, third week, of how to keep hold one thought steady in your mind and try to keep bringing the mind back. How does it happen? It won't happen on its own. Maybe for somebody who have done it in the previous births. But for most of it is an effort, like this child. See, she'll keep running, you have to pull her back, dissuade her from doing all things, and sometimes she would listen, sometimes she would not listen. So that is how keeping the, bringing the mind back again and again to the same thought. How is it possible is the question. That is the third week. And the fourth week is Om Pranavo Dhanu Sharohi Atma. And how to reach that? Brahman. Okay. So I don't want to give you all the gyan in the very one session, because it will be too much to digest. So I'm releasing little by little by little as much as you can eat. But why I'm telling you today about this, not just thoughts, but observe them as desires. Because you're pursuing them. If it was just a thought, suppose sitting in meditation, and suddenly a thought came, oh, that was a nice photo of Swami in the mandir. No problem. I must have one photo like this in my home. Problem. That way you observe them. And as I told yesterday, why do I put this effort to speak? Not that I need to memorize it, or not that I need to show my panditiyam to anybody. I don't have to do that. I do it because I want you to remain soaked in these thoughts. I don't want you to deviate from these thoughts. So all the time if you're listening, Shrutriyasya, that part I'm taking care of. You're listening and understanding the Shruti. Akamahatasya, you take care of discarding your desires and thoughts. If you both come together, guaranteed. If not Brahmananda, at least some Prajapati, on some level we will be able to achieve. Actually, there is no level. Quality of Ananda is the same. Is the length and period of it, that's all. Manushyananda is one unit, momentary. Brahmananda is eternal, permanent. That's all it is. And why I'm putting this effort? Because as I said, I need jnanis. I need those dhiras, viras, who will not be deflected, who will not get distracted, who will not deviate and remain steady and focused, and they will attain the ultimate. And because of their strength and steadiness, they will take this message to more people and teach them, and through them they will go to many more people. That is the idea. Okay. So I know some of you might be enjoying it because you have that sattva buddhi, as I said the other day. Yathatato upadeshena kritartha sattva buddhiman. Whatever discourse you give, a person with pure buddhi will get kritartha, he'll understand, he'll become fulfilled. Ajivimapi jignyasu paratastra vimuhyate. Parastatra vimuhyate means that ultimate principle evades him, eludes him. Who? Ajivimapi, entire life of a jignyasu, idle curiosity, not interested. All I was interested in, whether I'll get to sing bhajan today or not. Who wanted to listen to the discourse? All I was interested to have a darshan, pass on my letter full of worries. I was not interested in listening to it. Such people, ajivamapi jignyasu. But they will ask plenty of questions thereafter. Why this, why not, like this boy. He's having a desire to know God, also not an impediment. Because he has thought it from an intellectual point of view. Okay, good. They are young, they need to understand. I am ready to answer those questions. As long as there is a Shraddha. So please put this kind of effort. And as I said, I am not even looking at having the whole hall turned into jnanis. Even a few people come, I can delegate my work to four more people. It reduces some of my work. not reduces, but instead it multiplies my work to many more and many more places. But if that is not attained at the end of this whole life, it's a sheer waste. Sheer waste. Everything else we do and attain is a sheer waste. It will not matter at the end. Only that will matter which will take you to God and your realization. And don't get worried that once realization happens, how will I be? Will I be eating food or will I not be eating food? Will I? You will be doing everything and more with more intensity and interest. You will do better. Everything you will do better. Your memory will become so sharp. Your intelligence will become so pure and brilliant that anything and everything you will be able to grasp. That kind of, in every sphere, you will be healthy physically, mentally you will be alert and sharp, intelligent, bright, and also pure in your heart. All benefits will come to you on its own because of the attainment of that realization. That, okay? So we must put this effort and not leave it halfway through. When I am putting so much of effort, and for one reason that some of you at least will take it seriously and reach, raise yourself and reach there, so that you can go and promote and propagate this work what Adi Shankara and others have begun. But we have produced, as India, unfortunate thing is that we have produced a lot of intellectuals, tremendous philosophers, lot of debaters, but very few jnanis. So that's where our problem is. As I said yesterday, it's like a funnel. Many hear, few think, very few deliberate, and very, very few practice. And those who practice, in that one or two thing. Manushyanam sahasreshu kaschit yatati siddhaye. Some, after thousands of people, some put effort. Krishna said in Dwapara Yuga, where population was very less. Today I can say, manushyanam billioneshu or millioneshu, because that is the billion is correct actually. In billions, a few put efforts. And in those who put effort, yatatam api siddhanam kaschit, again a very few, veti tatvatha, they understand it completely, they understand this, realize it, very few. So billions will, out of billions, a few put effort, out of those few put effort, some ultimately realize. Should you be in that sum is my question. That question you should ask yourself. I want to be in that sum. I want to be in that group. That group of God, that group of realized beings, that group of jnanis. Because that is how you can help me. Somebody asked me, how can I help you, Swami, in your mission? I said, become me. That is the best help you can render to me. Because when one Sai Baba can do some amount of work, two Sai Babas can do double of it. And three Sai Babas can triple it. So the only way you can help me is to become me. And how do you become me? Desireless. And know their truth. If that you can become, you can help me, you can help the whole world. And that time has come now. This time, at this moment, this land of Bharat is having people who can take this knowledge, this jnana, not just intellectual experience. It's not an intellectual realization, it's an experiential realization. They can take it to the world. We want people, more and more and more people like that. That is the whole effort. So please put that effort. If you do it very well for this month, that is till May end, June, if we are here and if we spend some time, then I will talk about Upanishads and the secrets of Upanishad. Just to keep our mind always, you see, the gulab jamun should be in the syrup, for that sake only. I would like our students and teachers to get up, and if you tell, please speak about Bharatiya Vedanta, they should speak from their experience. Even an hour long speech they should be able to deliver with their experience. Thresholds are very low, entrance thresholds are very, very low, and this is the best time. When the tide is low, you can swim and cross the river. When tides increase, we don't know when water swells, we don't know whether we can swim again or not. This is the best time. And what else you require? Your coach is by your side. In case you drown also, sink also, he'll pick you up and take you across, saying, at least you have put the effort, grace marks. I will take you across. Even if you have jumped into the water and tried a few strokes. So this is the best time. Use that. I cannot tire myself speaking about it because this is what it is. I can speak about it and I'm so interested in some people at least. Will take it so seriously and put an effort and finally join me on this side. And help me spread this to the rest of the world and pull out so many people who are ignorantly living such ignorance. Stuck, drowned in them and not even realizing that they are sinking. A madman, if he falls in a well, what does he realize? An ignorant man falls into a river, what does he realize? A drunkard. Does he realize anything? If he's sinking also, he doesn't realize he's sinking. That is the kind of drunk with the world. People are sinking, but they don't even realize it. Somebody who is not drunk, who is aware, jagrita, he has to go and pull them out and make them realize that you are in danger, but you have been rescued. So that is the idea of this whole effort.
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा
करो भगवान।
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा,
प्रेमामृत बरसाओ बाबा,
दया करो भगवा,
दया करो भगवा,
कृपा करो
करो।